Today on Studio One, a horse is a horse, unless you're looking for particular traits. We'll talk to a couple of horse breeders who explain some very different breeds. Also, one woman says she takes care of a family of 40. We'll see how she does it as we spend a day in the life of a sorority house mom. And we'll preview the movie October Sky.
From the University of North Dakota, with Monty Cashel and Jamie Kasager, this is Studio One.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Studio One.
We're glad you could join us today. Monty, there's been a little bet made between the governor of Minnesota and the governor of New Mexico.
Well, these wagers are always interesting. What's happening now?
The governor of New Mexico is challenging Jesse Ventura, the mind or body, whatever, to a wrestling match.
Okay.
And the deal is, if New Mexico wins, then Minnesota is supposed to give up its 10,000 lakes. But if Minnesota wins, then New Mexico has to give up its 10,000 sand dunes.
I'll bet they don't even wrestle because those wagers are pretty high.
I think so.
Coming up on the show, 20 million people in the U.S. suffer from a disease that sometimes goes undetected. We'll learn how a simple thyroid self-check can save lives.
And the number of children that need foster parents in the U.S. is climbing. We'll talk to a woman that tries to help children who need foster care.
But first, today's news with Jim Bush.
All right, thank you, Monty and Jamie. Fruits and vegetables are considered the healthiest of all foods, but certain ones you choose might not be so safe. A study by the Consumers Union shows that there are unsafe levels of pesticide residue in some fruits and vegetables. Among those with high levels are apples, grapes, and peaches. Even though some foods are considered safer than others, researchers feel it is important to choose fruits and vegetables carefully.
It's not about fear of food. People should not be afraid to feed their kids lots of healthy fruits and vegetables. It's about giving people information so they can make smart choices.
Researchers suggest to wash foods with very diluted dishwashing soap or peel foods to avoid toxic chemicals. Two people are dead and 22 others injured after two trains collided in southern Germany. One woman was pulled dead from the wreckage while another male passenger died later in the hospital. The cause of the accident remains unknown, but it appears that the last two carriages of an express train derailed and hit a regional train traveling in the opposite direction. Since Germany's last crash, which killed over 100 people last year, German railways have been under pressure to take more safety precautions. Out of those injured in this crash, eight remain in critical condition. New statements on wine labels will soon point out benefits of drinking wine. The United States Treasury Department is allowing new statements which will post references to some positive effects wine can have on people's health, such as reduced risk of heart disease. The manager of one liquor store says the new statements on the labels is a victory for the wine industry.
Anytime something's new or you hear about things in the paper, you know, if there's some health benefits to it, there definitely will be an advantage for being in the wine business.
Some people are concerned the new labels will give mixed messages and may heavily increase the consumption of wine. Health experts say people should drink in moderation. That means only 1 5-ounce glass of wine a day for women and no more than 2 glasses a day for men. Scientists are finding that human and dolphin chromosomes share many similarities. A study comparing the two chromosomes show they are alike in many ways, except for how they are arranged. This discovery may lead to an increased understanding of how toxins released in the air are affecting humans. The study began after biologists observed an increased mortality rate and reduced reproduction among marine mammals. Since these animals are being exposed to the same pollutants that humans are, biologists are concerned. They're continuing to search for the answers that will hopefully help dolphins and eventually humans as well. The largest generation in American history will be turning age 55 less than 2 years from now. But for many of them, retirement seems a long way off. Purdue University researchers found that a majority of workers feel they will still have to work at least part-time during their retirement.
I think it's pretty scary to think about retiring and just looking at Social Security, because the way Social Security is in trouble now, I think that, you know, 10 years down the road while I'm looking at retirement, I think we're going to have some problems there, you know.
Like many other middle-aged Americans, Yanish is concerned about what his finances will be like after retirement. The Bureau of Labor Statistics says that by age 65, only 5% of Americans have an adequate capital for retirement. 63% are dependent on Social Security, family, or friends, and 3% are still working.
A lot of people just, you know, they think they're saving some money, but they don't realize that once they come, you know, to 55 or 60 years old and they want to retire, that all they're going to have is Social Security and whatever they have in some savings account. They're going to need some sort of other income, and I don't think a lot of people realize that.
According to Cass Gase, most workers who do have retirement plans have them through their employer. For those without a plan, things could get tight, especially as the first of millions of baby boomers turns 55 in 2001. Many analysts predict the massive amount of retirees leaving the workforce financially unprepared will put a stranglehold on the already burdened Social Security system. And many middle-aged Americans are worried that by the time they retire, Social Security and their savings may not be enough. Financial advisors recommend that all workers, regardless of their employer benefits or age, should invest any extra money in specialized savings plans. That's the news. Now more with Monty and Jamie.
Thanks, Jim. There's a lot of investment analysts say that you should always start early.
I haven't taken their advice yet. I suppose I probably should, though.
Oh, I'm sure that you've got money stashed all over the place.
You know me too well, Monty. Let's go over to the Regional Weather Information Center with Mike Brookbank to get our weather. Mike?
Hi, Jamie and Monty. Well, they always say save up for a rainy day, but that's not going to be happening anytime in the near future. It looks like people in our region will still be saving their money. Let's first take a look at our current conditions right now in Grand Forks. The temperature is 13 degrees. The dew point is 3. The wind is out of the east-northeast at 9 miles per hour. That's creating a wind chill of minus 3. And the pressure is 30.19 inches of mercury. Taking a look at temperatures across the region, we do see some warm air down to our south and west. Denver's at 44. Billings at 42. As we look to our east, we do see that Minneapolis-St. Paul is at 27 and Duluth, Minnesota at 21. Looking at our surface, our satellite image, we do see that there are cloudy skies for North Dakota and South Dakota, and the culprit for that is an area of low pressure which is farther down to our south and east. When we look on our surface map, we do see that that area of low pressure is down over the Gulf states, providing rain for them down there, and a lot of moisture up and down the eastern seaboard, as a couple areas of low pressure bring rain to that region. If you're traveling to the east coast, do check ahead with your airline. There are several delays. Looking at Friday morning, we do see an area of high pressure in the center of the United States. But looking up to the north and west, we do see another area of low pressure, which will be moving into our region by the beginning of next week. And that same area of low pressure down to the south and east, providing rain for Florida and Georgia. Animating into Friday evening, we do see that that chance for snow moves closer to our region, but just not a lot of moisture associated with this, so don't expect too much but some partly cloudy skies. As for highs on Fridays, we do see teens to the north and 20s to the south for places like Fargo and Bismarck. For Friday's lows, we do see single digits to the north for Grand Forks and Winnipeg, but teens for most of the rest of North Dakota and 20s farther to the south. As for highs on Saturday, we do see that there are 20s for Grand Forks and Winnipeg, 30s farther out west for Bismarck, and 30s down towards the south for Minneapolis-St. Paul. As for lows on Saturdays, teens for much of North Dakota and South Dakota, which is about seasonal for this time of year, we usually go down to about zero. For all of your up-to-date weather information, please turn to our homepage at www.arwick.und.edu. Monty and Jamie, get outside and enjoy the sunny skies.
Thanks, Mike.
Well, spring's right around the corner.
It is.
And so spring training. I know that Garth Brooks, the country singer, said that he's not going to the Grammys this year because instead he's fulfilling a lifelong dream and he's going to be practicing with the San Diego Padres.
Really?
Yeah, so he likes baseball. And also he's also doing it so he can, it says he has a new charity foundation, Touch 'Em All, Teammates for Kids. He wants to promote that.
Well, that's good too.
Let's go to our teammate, Brian Sean, for sports news.
Thank you, Monty and Jamie. The Minnesota Timberwolves are off to a fast start this year at 4-2, thanks mainly to young stars Stephon Marbury and Kevin Garnett, who are averaging 38 points and 13 rebounds a game between them. We go to the highlights between Houston and Minnesota. Sam Mitchell misses, Akeem Olajuwon with the rebound, throws a deep pass, touchdown to Scottie Pippen for two of his 12 points, Houston up two at the half. But Stephon Marbury, way too much in this one, causes the steal. Joel Smith recovers, gets it back up to Marbury, who cruises in for two of his game-high, career-high 40, 12 assists to go along. Kevin McHale wondering how he's going to pay him next year. Spurs Suns, Tim Duncan. Game high 20 for him, Spurs up two at the half. But Jason Kidd, a triple-double in this one, right to left, fading away, 14-footer in the lane, good. Suns go on to win this one 79-76. Now to the frozen pond. Leafs at the Sabres. Steve Sullivan with a shot. Dominic Koscheck says you'll get nothing and like it. Sullivan gets his chance again, though, on the feed from Matt Sundin, who puts it in the one-timer. 12th of the season, Leafs go on to win 3-2. Air pollution is not something you think of when entering an indoor ice rink, but a Harvard study published in the American Journal of Public Health shows poor air quality in ice rinks is a potential problem. Propane or gasoline-powered ice resurfacing equipment and poor ventilation in some arenas may lead to high levels of carbon monoxide and nitrous oxides. Some researchers say this could lead to respiratory problems and other health concerns. Although no national standards are yet in place, three states, Maryland, Massachusetts, and Minnesota, regulate ice rink air quality. Rink managers in these states say if they don't comply with state laws, they could be shut down.
We're required by law to take carbon monoxide readings and nitrogen readings once a week.
Although the health effects of typical exposures are unknown, the levels may be of concern to people who spend large amounts of time in rinks. And now it's time for our Studio One Sports Trivia Question of the Week. This week's question, what year did the National Basketball Association originate? I'll have the answer to that and more in the second half hour of sports. But first, here's Monty and Jamie.
Thank you, Brian. Still ahead on the show, organizing a household can be a hectic job. We'll see how one mother runs a house with over 40 members and enjoys it.
Really? Also, a simple self-check of your thyroid can save your life. We'll learn more about thyroid disease and how to prevent it next.
We're a very smart family. We wanted a warm house, a cozy fire, hot dogs on the grill, lots of hot water, and saving money. So we chose natural gas from NSP, the wise energy choice.
It's how you look, it's how you feel. You have a style, you have a feel.
When it comes to style, quality, and convenience, Columbia Mall is the area's ultimate shopping destination. With three major department stores and over 80 inviting shops and boutiques, you'll love the way things look.
When you look for more,
we started out as a little old bank, but as your needs got bigger, so did we, and we're still growing. And we want you to know that today, Community National Bank can serve every single financial need that you and your family have. But we also want you to know this, we'll never get so big that you can't get close to us. Community National Bank. We care about you.
The University of North Dakota has a rich history of retaining and graduating American Indian students. UND offers 28 American Indian programs, more than any other higher education institution in the United States. The support services provided by Native American programs ensure student success. Native American programs offer tutoring, academic advising, and financial aid assistance, which makes UND a leader in Indian education. For more information, call 1-800-CALL-UND. That's 1-800-CALL-UND.
Studio One, news, weather, sports, and entertainment.
The symptoms of thyroid disease can be so subtle. Many of the symptoms resemble the common cold. Here to talk about thyroid disease and its prevention is Dr. William Zaks. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Oh, my pleasure. Glad to be here.
What exactly is the thyroid disease?
Well, thyroid disease refers to any disease of the thyroid gland, which is an organ in the base of the neck and the front of the throat that produces a hormone, thyroid hormone. And any malfunction of that gland is referred to as thyroid disease.
Is it pretty common?
It is very common. It's one of the more common endocrine disorders. Underactive thyroids are seen in about 2% of the population in the U.S., a similar frequency for overactive thyroid. And nodules or growths on the thyroid can be seen in 4-7% of the population. So it is fairly a frequent disorder.
Does it matter, like, for female or males? Is it more common in one or the other?
It is more common in females. It's probably about 10 times more common in women than men, all thyroid diseases added together.
Okay, younger or older, does it make a difference for that?
Certain diseases are more common as you get older, nodules, for example. Other types of thyroid disease, autoimmune diseases, which are most common thyroid diseases, tend to occur more often in middle age. But there's generally some increased frequency as you do get older.
Okay. Are there various types of thyroid disease? I know you were talking about underactive or overactive. Is that part of the disease?
We classify it usually into an underactive or hypothyroidism as one class, and hyperthyroidism or overactive thyroid is another. And there are different causes for each one, but that's sort of a general description. And nodular disease is a different class altogether, referring to just abnormal growths or lumps on the thyroid.
Okay, and what are some of the common symptoms that you can check for?
One thing you mentioned is a screening for thyroid disease that people can do at home. Since the thyroid is in the front of the throat, if somebody were to tilt their head back and drink a glass of water, the thyroid normally rises up in the throat when one swallows. And you can look at yourself when you're drinking in a mirror. And if you see any lump or enlargement or fullness in the lower part of the throat when you swallow, that's an indication that you may have a thyroid enlargement. And most thyroid diseases are associated with enlargement of the thyroid. Underactive thyroids have their own group of symptoms associated with them as well. People tend to feel cold, tired. They tend to gain weight, maybe be constipated. Have difficulty thinking or memory problems. On the other hand, an overactive thyroid has a different type of symptoms. There, people tend to feel warm, sweaty, may notice rapid heart rate, feel fatigued, get short of breath easily if they exert themselves, have loose bowel movements. So there are different symptom groups that are associated with both an overactive and an underactive thyroid. Nodules, on the other hand, usually patients don't have any symptoms. They're usually normal thyroid function, and all they may feel is a lump in the throat. Often, patients aren't aware of it, and that's why self-screening examinations are important. Often, it's picked up by the patient's first personal physician, and they're the first ones that notice a lump in the throat.
Is there any kind of prevention that a person can do to prevent themselves from getting this disease?
Not really, no. There really isn't a prevention.
Just to kind of...
It's just something that you should be aware of. Often thyroid diseases run in families, so if there is a family history of somebody else having the disease, they should be more aware of the symptoms and bring it to the attention of their doctor, who should be screening them for it.
All right, and if it's left untreated, what would happen then?
Well, patients can actually live without a thyroid. It's not essential for life. You'll feel pretty sluggish without one, certainly. But the major concern is nodules, because they could be a sign of thyroid cancer. Most thyroid cancers are very easily treatable. You remove the nodule and you're cured. But rarely thyroid cancer can spread to the rest of the body, and people do die from it. So that's the most serious form of thyroid disease. Certain forms of overactive thyroid, too, although generally well-tolerated, if somebody were to get an associated illness like a bad viral illness or gastroenteritis, they could be very sick as well. It's something called thyroid storm.
Okay. Are there any complications with thyroid surgery? You mentioned cancer, thyroid cancer. Then you would have surgery to get that taken care of, right?
Right. Okay. Yeah, the treatment is surgery. Usually the surgery is very safe. There's probably about a 1-2% risk of complications, and those would include damage to one of the nerves controlling the vocal cords, so you may have a hoarseness or a deepening of the voice. Often that's only transient and it would clear up on its own. There's also about a 1-2% risk of damaging parathyroid glands that control your calcium levels in your blood, so you could have a low calcium for a short time as well. And there's always a risk of any anesthesia involved with surgery, but that's generally very infrequent.
All right. Thank you so much for this information, Dr. Zaks.
Sure. My pleasure.
The childhood dreams of one NASA scientist is now the plot of a new movie by Universal Pictures. We'll preview October Sky later on in the show. But first, we'll see how one woman comforts others when they are leaving away from home. Thank you.
Let the University of North Dakota become your strategic partner by providing your business, industry, or organization with our workforce development services. Our experts work closely with you to enhance your workforce productivity. Together, we'll help you develop innovative and practical solutions. The Office of Workforce Development has extensive experience in customizing educational programs and services. Call us for further information. Workforce Development, a service of the University of North Dakota. The University of North Dakota's Division of Continuing Education can help you learn throughout your lifetime. Begin or continue your education through correspondence study, extended degree programs, and extension courses. For your personal or professional growth, we offer conferences as well as courses in dietary management and real estate.
We invite you to contact us at the Division of Continuing Education to discuss your learning opportunities.
Call us or look us up on the World Wide Web.
The academics are really strong. The professors, they really challenge you to learn and to apply your knowledge.
I think there's many different opportunities in different places that students can go on and off campus.
School of Engineering Mines is kind of one close-knit community. Everybody's friendly. You're not just, you know, a name in the crowd or a number.
I've always wanted to do engineering. What we're learning here is just hands-on.
The department has been very good about acquiring the resources we need.
I think that through this project I've gained a lot of the team working skills, leadership.
A campus that supports a wide range of degrees gives you a nice ability to round out your education in a variety of areas.
All families need a caregiver. That goes especially for a family that consists of 40 women. We recently spent a day in the life of a sorority house mom.
Eunice Grazer is a house mother in one of the many sorority houses in the United States. House moms maintain the house, plan the meals, and help the sorority members with any kind of problems. She says even though it is like a 24-hour job, she loves it.
What makes it all worthwhile is I get to really know the girls, and they appreciate what I do and that I'm here for them, and the many thank yous I get.
Eunice says she never liked to live alone. 11 years ago, she decided to become a house mom when her own children finished college. She says this is like a second family for her.
My own family gets a little jealous of my other family and how much time I put in, but it's my job and I love it, so.
She hangs out with us, she plays games with us, encourages us to do stuff, goes out to eat with us if we go out sometimes and stuff like that.
But she is much more than a mom.
Stacy, what do you need fixed today? So, Justin, get those dishes unloaded now. Solitaire. I play solitaire. I always tell them I'm coming down to do... I can't even get solitaire on here right now.
Many who have graduated still keep in touch with Eunice. She often gets wedding invitations, baby announcements, or simply letters telling her how much she means to past sorority members. Eunice has made a difference in many lives by doing something she enjoys, being a mother for 40 women. I am Lisa Jensen reporting for Studio One.
Eunice says being a house mom is about caring, being a role model, and having an open mind. Homer Hickam Jr. is a NASA scientist who will get to see his own dream come true on film. October Sky is a movie which shows how Hickam struggled to get out of his predetermined life and become a scientist. With the help of three of his friends and the support of his chemistry teacher, he tries to build and launch a rocket. It will earn him a scholarship if he succeeds.
His father wants him to become a coal miner, and he doesn't want to become a coal miner, and he wants to be a scientist, and his father can't understand that, and they bump heads throughout the whole entire story.
The town Petros, Tennessee was taken over by the film crew and recreated into a 1957 mine town with remarkable accuracy. They even brought in a 1911 steam locomotive up from a Tennessee Railroad museum. October Skies opens in theaters everywhere Friday, February 19th. Now time to take a look at the events happening in your area.
Longer and brighter days may lie ahead of us. Russian scientists recently experimented with mirrors in space to reflect sunlight down to dark regions on Earth. So far, the mirrors are relatively small. They can light a 3 to 4 mile wide circle. Here are your thoughts on whether scientists should have the freedom to change Mother Nature's sleeping patterns.
I think they should just kind of leave it alone, because it could mess up the plants with their whether they should open or close, and the habitat won't know whether to be awake or asleep.
I think it's a good idea, because it's too cold here. Like, and longer summer days would be nice.
Yeah, if you want it to be warm, move to a place that has a warmer climate. So I'd say don't do the mirror thing.
I thought it was a wonderful thing that they were doing, especially the comment that they made about the disasters happening in the middle of the night, you know, and being able to shed some light. I was kind of disappointed it didn't work.
If they use it for emergency lighting, say if the power goes out or something like that, I don't have a problem with it. But just to change the length of the day, I don't think so.
A new style of country music is making its way up the charts. This up-and-coming band is not exactly what you would expect.
New and old country combine in order to pursue a lifelong dream of making it big in music. Dwayne Hyde formed his opera-style band in order to try to please different styles of audiences.
I think the most important ones that come to our show are good people. Everyone that comes to our show, we love them all, and they love us.
The show is called Opry-Style because it features many different performers. Band members say Opry-Style is growing. The performers in the show have very different styles of music to contribute.
The thing that I always like to hear is there's a lot of older people that come to our show, and they'll come up to me and they'll say, it was my first concert. You see some older people. And so I think we've given them a cause to leave their homes on Friday or Saturday night.
The show is called a variety show because of the different styles of music they perform.
We always stay very focused on the people that come to our shows. They are the bread and butter of any band, and we always have to stay very focused on that.
The audience is remembered wherever the band goes.
We want to take all the folks from North Dakota, South Dakota, the upper Midwest. We like to feel that they're with us, and when we go on that stage at the Grand Ole Opry, we're doing it not just for us, but for them.
The most recently released album by the Dwayne Hyde Band was named 1998 Airplay International Country Album of the Year. No one in the band dreamed of fame, but it's slowly coming true. Dwayne feels that all of the Opry singers will soon find their way to the top. I'm Tanya Parr, reporting for Studio One.
The band is planning to continue playing in the Midwest. They hope to broaden their touring area throughout the United States and Canada. Children need a caring home. Next, we'll talk to a social worker and see how times are changing in foster care. Plus, saddle up and learn how horse breeding can be rewarding, both financially and emotionally. That story plus news, sports, and the updated weather forecast in the next half hour on Studio One.
I started out in a one-room country school. It was about the only one left in the state. I thought about being a doctor ever since I was a little kid.
Let me take a listen to you here. Yeah. Some big, deep breaths in and out through your mouth, please.
UND School of Medicine, I feel, prepared me very well. The quality of the education was excellent. I definitely was looking to stay in a rural area. A lot of our graduates tend to stay in state. It's a real benefit to North Dakota.
Summer Session 99. We guarantee warm weather. The University of North Dakota has a rich history of retaining and graduating American Indian students. UND offers 28 American Indian programs, more than any other higher education institution in the United States. The support services provided by Native American programs ensure student success. Native American programs offer tutoring, academic advising, and financial aid assistance, which makes UND a leader in Indian education. For more information, call 1-800-CALL-UND. That's 1-800-CALL-UND.
The University of North Dakota's College of Business and Public Administration is nationally and internationally recognized as a center of excellence.
We actually created a business plan for this small retail store, which is now being used.
It's introducing me to technology that'll be used in my business work environment.
For more information about the UND College of Business and Public Administration, phone 1-800-CALL-UND.
From the University of North Dakota, with Monty Cashel and Jamie Kasager, this is Studio One.
Welcome back to Studio One.
Thanks for joining us.
Well, Monty, it's winter, and that means bad driving conditions usually.
Good old ice and rubber just doesn't mix.
No, it doesn't. But in Pennsylvania and in Europe, they've done this a few years ago, but they're making, like, these sensor things that go on bridges that when they sense, like, snow or ice is going to be coming, it'll spray off like a liquid salt.
Liquid salt.
Yes.
So then all the ice has gone off the bridge.
Mm-hmm. You don't need any like road workers or anything. They just automatically go off.
Now that is a good idea.
Isn't it?
Where did it originate?
So, I think in Switzerland, they said. So it's been around Europe for a few years. Mm-hmm. So
the snowy places.
Mm-hmm.
Well, coming up in the next 30 minutes on Studio One, performance-enhancing drugs fill health food store shelves. We'll see if these drugs are helpful or harmful to those that take them.
Also, we'll get into the brain with someone that loves breeding horses with a history.
And we'll learn how foster care tries to add permanence to children's lives. And there are many children out there who are looking for foster homes. We'll find out more about that. Mm-hmm. But first, today's news with Jim Bush.
Thanks once again, Monty and Jamie. Prosecutors in a Texas hate crime are using tattoos from a defendant to prove his guilt. They say dozens of white supremacist tattoos on the body of murder defendant John King show he had motive. King is one of three men accused of murdering African-American James Byrd Jr. According to the Jasper Police, one of the tattoos on King's body depicts a black man being hung from a tree. Officials say Byrd died after he was dragged behind a pickup truck last summer. Another murder case is also in the spotlight. U.S. officials won their two-year-long battle to extradite the famous fugitive Ira Einhorn today. Einhorn, the former counterculture guru, skipped bail in 1981 after the body of his then-girlfriend Holly Maddox was found in a suitcase in his Philadelphia home. In 1993, while he was still on the run, Einhorn was tried for Maddox's murder by Pennsylvania prosecutors. He was found guilty and given a life sentence. 18 months ago, Einhorn was arrested by French police. Defense attorneys representing Einhorn say they will appeal the decision to the French Supreme Court. A dull, repetitive textbook may be the reason children are having trouble in math. A recent survey by the American Association for the Advancement of Science found that 8 out of 12 middle school math books do not promote student thinking or independent learning. A study is the second in recent months to find that boring material is to blame for American students doing poorly in school. But some educators believe that a strong family life and value system is just as important.
Kids start slipping here and the parents don't slip with them and stay with them, and that gets to be a difficult challenge too. So it isn't just textbooks, which is the topic of our discussion. It isn't just the curriculum. It's a whole lot more than that.
Gruel says a positive environment for studying is also very important. A scientist constructing a device that will measure time by the millenniums, computer specialist Danny Hillis has designed an eternal clock. This monumental device will tick annually and chime every 1,000 years for the next 10 millenniums. After the clock strikes midnight next New Year's Eve, this $500,000 device will be relocated in the desert. Hillis chose the location so people will have to travel on foot to see it. Hillis hopes his clock will tell a story to the future onlookers about our time and civilization. An all-natural muscle enhancer may be helping bodybuilders maximize their physical performance, but the negative side effects remain uncertain.
When working out at the gym, most people want instant results. An increasingly popular muscle enhancer is helping bodybuilders become stronger and bigger faster. Creatine monohydrate is a natural occurring substance found in our muscle tissue. When taken in a powder form, it can enhance muscle tone, increase muscle strength, and improve weightlifting endurance. After using creatine for just a couple weeks, one user was pleased with his results.
And the weights that I was lifting, more weights I was able to lift up, I had increased muscle mass. My body weight increased all within about a week and a half to 2 weeks.
As for side effects, nothing has been proven, but some creatine users have complained about severe muscle cramping. No long-term effects have been determined either. Researchers continue to test for these and any other possible dangers.
You can hear some pretty good horror stories from the athletic training community as far as athletes that have cramped up terribly, found out they were on creatine, and they made that link.
Unlike steroids, this boost of anaerobic energy is natural and considered to be safe. That is, if you keep in mind, more is not better. If used in proper dosages, creatine can be extremely effective.
You know, it was good. I didn't have any side effects, and so I've been off it long enough now that, you know, I can see it did have some good benefits.
As for now, creatine is considered safe for people over 18 years of age. Researchers continue to study whether adding the muscle with creatine is worth it in the long run. I'm Joanna Storti reporting for Studio One.
Creatine is available in most natural food stores and nutrition centers. Around the country, undercover police officers are masquerading as customers in liquor stores to curb a growing problem. Cops and Shops is a program organized to deter minors from purchasing alcohol. Cops and Shops uses undercover police who may follow you from the liquor store if they feel you are possibly supplying alcohol to a minor. Cops and Shops is sponsored by larger beverage distillers in the U.S. and helps curb underage drinking by keeping the program in the public eye. The idea is to make it difficult for underage drinkers to get alcohol.
You know, if you just ignore it, it's easy. And the whole idea behind any program of interdiction is to make it not easy.
Beck says because the word is out about the program, there are not many arrests. He says police gauge the success of Cops and Shops by the number of arrests they don't make. That's all the news. Now more with Monty and Jamie.
Thank you, Jim. Well, you can trust the police. They've always got these creative ways to find out problems. And
they've always got some kind of program, right?
That's right.
Let's go over now to the Regional Weather Information Center with Mike Brookbank for our updated weather. Mike?
Well, Monty and Jamie, you don't want the weather police after you or anyone else this weekend. You better get outside and enjoy the weather. We'll tell you how that's going to shape up, but first, our current conditions in Grand Forks. We're right now seeing a temperature of 12 degrees. The dew point is 2. The wind is light out of the northeast at 6 miles per hour, and there is a wind chill of 5 below. The pressure is 30.19 inches of mercury. The jet stream looks something like this. We do see a ridge building in the southwest and a trough building into the east. As we animate the jet stream, we do see that the polar air stays over our region, but there really isn't a main outbreak of Arctic air. The warmer air stays down to the south. For Saturday's weather, we do see an area of high pressure over our region. And as we look towards Tuesday, we do see that there is a chance for snow and rain in the southwest. And by Tuesday night into Wednesday, this system could be bringing snow and rain to the cities. As we look at your weekend outlook, we do see that we're expecting cooler temperatures and clear skies. So if you don't want the police after you, you better get outside and enjoy the weather. Monty and Jamie.
Thanks, Mike.
No, we wouldn't want that to happen.
No, we better get outside.
I know there's a lot of things you can be doing outside right now. The only thing is you got to watch that wind. Once the wind picks up, everything changes. So
you're right.
Well, the wind, the spring wind is in the air. There's lots of things happening in sports. Spring training starting. Let's go now to Brian Sean. He's got some news for us.
Thank you, Monty and Jamie. Being disabled does not stop some athletes from competing in the sports they love. Wheelchair basketball is not only a competitive sport, but an opportunity for these people to meet people, gain confidence, and have fun.
It's not your typical game of hoops, but wheelchair basketball is definitely a unique one. This challenging game not only requires a dedicated athlete, but also a lot of focus and concentration.
We work really hard in practices, as you can tell. This is a very hard sport, but it's really gratifying and really fun to play.
One team in Grand Forks, North Dakota calls itself the Wallbangers. They are just one of hundreds of teams in the nation that travel across the country and compete against other teams. The team is quite diverse, made up of females and males, both young and old. But they all compete for the same purpose, to have fun.
We have a great time. We socialize quite a bit. We socialize with other people with other disabilities so that we understand more different disabilities.
Each of the specially designed athletic wheelchairs costs each athlete close to $2,500. But the high expense is well worth it as the athletes enjoy the chance to play. They say that staying active is very important and sports are a positive experience for them.
It gives them the pride of confidence, or, you know, the
confidence that they need. It's nice to see them out there and being able to do things. You know, it's their pride builder.
Not only that, but it just goes to show that these athletes are able to play and compete just like anybody else. For Studio One Sports, I'm Chrissy Super.
Most of the rules are similar to that of regular basketball, as wheelchair athletes can even fall out of games. And now it's time for the answer of our Studio One Sports Trivia Question of the Week. This week's question, what year did the NBA originate? The answer, 1946. That's all for sports today, Monty and Jamie.
Thank you, Brian. People across the country are opening their homes to children in need. We'll talk to a woman that helps place kids in foster homes.
Also, we'll see what it takes to breed Arabian and miniature horses, which I'm sure is completely two different things.
Totally different.
That story is next on Studio One.
Sioux pride. The championship tradition is strong at the UND bookstore. Before the game, shop the UND bookstore for the largest selection of officially licensed Sioux products. No matter what your sport, the UND bookstore can help you show your Sioux colors. The UND bookstore welcomes all alumni, friends, and Sioux fans. Shop for quality name brand clothing, Sioux collectibles, books, and supplies. Come to the UND bookstore located in the Student Union.
I started out in a one-room country school. It was about the only one left in the state. I thought about being a doctor ever since I was a little kid.
Let me take a listen to you here. Yeah. Some big, deep breaths in and out through your mouth, please.
UND School of Medicine, I feel, prepared me very well. The quality of the education was excellent. I definitely was looking to stay in a rural area. A lot of our graduates tend to stay in state. It's a real benefit to North Dakota.
University of North Dakota's College of Business and Public Administration is nationally and internationally recognized as a center of excellence.
They motivate me by keeping me interested in the class, having it more interactive.
Before they can get accredited, they have to meet certain requirements, and it's a good school.
For more information about the UND College of Business and Public Administration, phone 1-800-CALL-UND.
Consider extending your learning into the summer months at the University of North Dakota. UND Summer Session is a great opportunity for all students. Summer classes can help you graduate early or on time. Raise your GPA while taking shorter classes with fewer classmates. Summer Session allows you to work and still take classes. Financial aid is available for those who qualify. Classes start in May and June. Registration begins April 6th. Call 1-800-CALL-UND for details. That's 1-800-CALL-UND.
You're watching Studio One, news, weather, sports, and entertainment.
Horse breeding first occurred during the ancient world in Greece and Rome. Large horses were bred for carrying armored soldiers into battle, and light horses were used for riding and racing. Even though tanks have replaced horses in wars, horse breeding still exists.
One of the most popular riding horses in the United States is the Arabian horse. Like the name implies, the breed's origin comes from the other side of the globe, Arabia, in the Middle East. The Arabian horse has the longest history of any breeds. Throughout its 3,500-year history, it has remained practically unchanged.
So it goes all the way back. All the horses that are called Arabians and are considered purebred Arabians have to trace all of their bloodlines way back to the desert.
Stephen Randall has been breeding Arabian horses since 1970.
You have to get Roy Rogers out of your blood sometime. So I've always liked horses, and then eventually found a farm, or moved out to a farm where we could have some, and we started raising horses. Got very involved in them, very consuming. I'm gonna put you in here. I'm gonna put you in here for a minute.
Arabian horses are known for their strength and stamina. It is not uncommon to hear stories throughout the history of Arabian horses traveling 50 or even 100 miles through the desert, day in and day out.
The Arabian looks more like a long-distance runner than it does as a or a wide receiver in football, rather than a person who's in the line. The wide receivers in football, they're running back and forth all day. So they got to be strong, and they're built in that way. Back to
the tail. Breeding Arabian horses is difficult, and Randall says the ideal Arabian horse needs certain characteristics. Some good traits include a small muscle, an arched swan-like neck, and a tail that picks up when running.
I never liked big horses, but every time I saw a miniature horse, of course, that was a different story.
Ernie Toon also loves horses. He started only 4 years ago, but already has 31 miniature horses.
I got more friends here now. This one is Clarence. That's Clarence. Somebody else named him that. I thought that was a cute name for a horse. Hey, to get attention, bite me on the cheek. Holy smokes.
While Randall is looking for a refined and beautiful horse, Tuna has a totally different approach. According to him, the smaller the horse, the better. The miniature horse is divided into different classes.
Anything under 34 inches is class A, and they, of course, bring more money. Then, of course, the class B goes all the way up to 38 inches. That makes a pretty big horse, you know.
This is a tri-colored horse. It has brown, white, and black. And this is actually a class B horse. It's 34 and a half inch, but it's still small. Miniature horses were first bred as early as the 16th century for the royal courts of Europe. As the great European kingdoms began to decline, minis found their way into traveling circuses. The continuous travel made breeding impossible, and minis almost became extinct. A few survived and were scattered throughout the world. They were then brought to America to work in the coal mines because of their size and strength.
And little Pee-wee here, I suppose we'll have to find a nice small male for you.
The breeding of miniature horses is fairly easy. Breeders take the smallest horses and mix them together. Minis also have certain characteristics to aim for, but Tuna likes the working horse more than the race horse.
Of course, that's my idea, and they say you should race what you like.
Miniature horses have become so small over the years that they actually are too small to ride on.
If you let a smaller kid ride the horse, the bigger brother wants to get on the horse and ride it, and that would probably be bad for the horse, you know.
Mini horses are friendly and have proven themselves as ambassadors of goodwill by participating in exhibitions, parades, and fairs.
These folks would have a little more spark to them than that kind of a horse. Hi, guy.
There are over 100,000 miniature horses registered in the United States today.
They'll never be extinct, I'm sure. Not as long as I live.
When people breed horses, they do something more than just earn money. These horses become lifelong friends, and they say it's often hard to sell them. I'm Bjorn Rood for Studio One.
Bjorn joins us in the studio to answer a couple questions. Very interesting story, very different types of horses. Now, what are the value of these horses?
Well, I don't know the market value, but because it goes up and down. But I know Randall, he sold one of his Arabian horses for $40,000.
Wow.
And then the horse was resold later for $100,000.
Okay, so it's just almost like cars and houses, they go up and down in value and
yeah.
All that.
But I think most of these guys are into the companionship and they make friends. Like Ernie Tuna, he has 31 horses and each horse has a name. And he calls them all kinds of weird names like Peavy and Hooly and Wooly and all that, yeah. So he has a great time breeding horses. He has lots of friends.
He has a lot of pets running around.
Oh, yeah.
Well, thanks a lot for the story, Bjorn. It's very interesting. You're watching Studio One. Stay with us.
Let the University of North Dakota become your strategic partner by providing your business, industry, or organization with our workforce development services. Our experts work closely with you to enhance your workforce productivity. Together, we'll help you develop innovative and practical solutions. The Office of Workforce Development has extensive experience in customizing educational programs and services. Call us for further information. Workforce Development, a service of the University of North Dakota.
School of Engineering Mines we're kind of one close-knit community. Everybody's friendly. You're not just, you know, a name in the crowd or a number.
I've always wanted to do engineering. What we're learning here is just hands-on.
The department has been very good about acquiring the resources we need.
I think that through this project I've gained a lot of the team working skills, leadership.
A campus that supports a wide range of degrees gives you a nice ability to round out your education in a variety of areas.
The academics are really strong. The professors, they really challenge you to learn and to apply your knowledge.
I think there's many different opportunities in different places that students can go on and off campus.
University of North Dakota's College of Business and Public Administration is nationally and internationally recognized as a center of excellence.
They motivate me by keeping me interested in the class, having it more interactive.
Before they can get accredited, they have to meet certain requirements, and it's a good school.
For more information about the UND College of Business and Public Administration, phone 1-800-CALL-UND.
Foster parents open their homes to kids in need. They provide bed and board, of course, but they also give youngsters stability, consistency, and guidance. Here to talk about foster care is foster care social worker Cindy Andrade. Thank you very much for coming on the show today.
Thank you for having me.
Now, foster care has been around for ages, and how is it changing now?
I think one of the biggest changes is actually the role of the foster parents. I think in the olden days, foster parents didn't have a big role. They weren't given a whole lot of information about the kids that came into their home. Now what we do is we try to give the foster parents as much information as we have about the children. Also, we request that they go to permanency planning meetings, so they play an active role in that. And they also do have contact with the natural parents of the child.
Okay. And many of the family situations now are different than they were even 30 years ago. The nuclear family, you know, isn't the norm anymore. There's a lot of single parents. Is that something, too, that you can be a single parent and have foster children?
Yes, you can. I think that's one myth that is out there. A lot of people think that if you are a single parent, you can't be a foster parent. That is not true. And the other myth is that most people think that you have to be a stay-at-home mom or dad to be a foster parent. And I would say the majority, roughly about 80% maybe of our foster parents here in Grand Forks County, both mom and dad work outside the home.
Are there any other national trends with foster care that are happening now?
I think the biggest one, first of all, is the move to foster adopt. And basically that is the push to get kids out of foster care and into permanent homes. Usually now, if a child does become available for adoption, the foster parents are approached first with that option to adopt the child that's been in their home. There also was a law passed in November of 1997, which is called the PASS Act, or the Adoption and Safe Families Act. And basically, like I said again, that is the push to get kids into permanent homes. If they can't be returned to a parent, it's to get them placed with a relative or else placed for adoption.
If someone wants to become a foster parent, do they have to go through any specific training or anything like that?
Yes, they do. There is a procedure that they go through. Basically, there's a fire safety training and an orientation training that they complete prior to being licensed. After that, basically, it's the paperwork process, getting the application filled out, and then there is training requirements each year for the years.
How much of a need is there for foster families?
There's always a need for foster families. I think especially for teenagers, but like I said, there always is a need for children of all ages, but I think we usually find it difficult to find people that are willing to take teenagers into their homes.
What about the relatives of the children that are looking for a foster family? Is it usual or unusual that they'd be placed with relatives?
No. Our priority is that children are returned to their parents. If that is not an option or that can't happen immediately, then what we'll look at is relatives. If there are relatives that are willing to provide a home for the child, and also if they are appropriate. So
it does happen quite often?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How many times after, say, a young child's put in a foster home, do the homes change?
I don't know if I have a statistic or a number to give you. I think we make it a priority to try and match the child to the foster home. We look at what the child's needs are and see if we can find the best match for that child. I think if we do that, you'll find that the kids don't have to be moved around so much. And we prefer that. The kids can stay in one home until they move on to something more permanent.
What are some of the barriers to the perfect foster care world?
Honestly, I don't think there ever has been or there probably ever will be a perfect foster care world. I think it depends upon where you live. There's a lot of barriers that could come into play. A lot of people have their own opinions, too, about just the foster care program in general.
Okay. Now, we usually think right away of children. What mm-hmm. about adults? Can adults mm-hmm. be placed in foster care as well?
Yeah, I think it's more of a voluntary placement. There is an adult foster care program through the aging services at our office. Basically, I think the criteria is that they have to be on medical assistance. And the adult foster care program is an alternative to nursing home care. So it could be for adults that are either developmentally disabled, mentally ill, basically just elderly, but they do have to be on medical assistance, and it is an alternative to nursing home care.
Now, is this something that is a different type of training and everything too?
It is a little bit different than what I do. It is, like I said, in the adult services program. I know they do have basic requirements that they have, that the foster homes have to complete in order to have an adult placed in their home.
Okay. What are some of the, I guess, to finish up, what are some of the newer ideas that are happening in foster care right now?
One of the things, again, is the foster adopt. We are now, the state of North Dakota developed what we call the PRIDE training curriculum, and that stands for Parents, Resources for Information, Development, and Education. And basically, we're now training our foster parents along with the adoptive parents. We just find it really helps to share their experiences. And you also find that a lot of adoptive parents have decided to go the foster care route and also will be willing to do foster care.
Okay, good. Thanks a lot for coming on the show today, Cindy.
Thank you for having me.
Very interesting.
Thank you.
We'll be right back after this.
Sioux Pride. The championship tradition is strong at the UND bookstore. Before the game, shop the UND bookstore for the largest selection of officially licensed Sioux products. No matter what your sport, the UND bookstore can help you show your Sioux colors. The UND bookstore welcomes all alumni, friends, and Sioux fans. Shop for quality name brand clothing, Sioux collectibles, books, and supplies. Come to the UND bookstore located in the Student Union.
Performance. The best way to gauge ours is to ask one of our clients, Voller Insurance. Insurance since 1947. We'd like to propose a unique partnership, one where we do all the work and not ask for 1 cent of your profits. Voller Insurance, your involved insurance partner.
It's how you look, it's how you feel. Style, you have a feel.
When it comes to style, quality, and convenience, Columbia Mall is the area's ultimate shopping destination. With 3 major department stores and over 80 inviting shops and boutiques, you'll love the way things look.
When you look for more, there's a lot to see. Columbia Mall, you look great to me.
Are you a parent looking for childcare? Do you know what good childcare looks like? Do you provide childcare and have questions? Does childcare affect your business? Do you have employees who are concerned about childcare? Doesn't every child deserve quality childcare? Any questions? Call Childcare Resource and Referral.
Tune in next week on Studio One. New technology is helping eliminate snoring. We'll let you in on the science that can give you a peaceful sleep. All that and much more next week on Studio One.
I know there's a few people who could take that snoring thing in.
I know my dad could use that.
Put my dad in front of the TV, he's out like a light. Well, we're going to leave you now with some pictures of Native American dancers, courtesy of photographer Bobby Paulos. From all of us here at Studio One, have a great week.